What about System of a Down, Toxicity?
There were a couple that I was okay with getting rid of, but harder than I thought it was going to be. Not going to lie. You want, Twan, you go first.
Okay, I'll go first. So full disclosure, and this is a fact. I listened to this album all the way through for the first time, front to back, in probably 15 years. I kind of channeled it back, probably 15 years. And I'm just going to put a statement out there before I get into the songs. I'm surprised this album got as big as it did. And that might sound like a diss. It's not. It's a praise. Not because I don't like it. I love it. It's classic. It captures that time perfectly and brilliantly. But the reason is, it's like, I don't know how or why the mainstream accepted it like it did. Like, the lyrics are not top 40.
It shouldn't have. You're right.
It's spastic. It ebbs and flows almost like a musical. I was trying to put it in my head. It just, there's thrashy parts that they could have stole from, I don't know. You know, anyway, you pick a big name or metal band, whatever. It just doesn't make sense. I mean, I know why, because of Chop Suey and because Ariel's, and that carried it. But man, this thing, it's properly rated. I don't think it outkicked its coverage, but man, they nailed it. They nailed it. It's a fantastic album. With that said, I did cut some.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to go through this actually pretty quick, and then we can react to it. So Jet Pilot, Bounce, Shimmy, Psycho, and Ardo. So Psycho, I mean, there's only so many times I can hear that song. Ardo is just instrumentals. Shimmy kind of has, no, Bounce has kind of the same impact as Psycho to me, which is like, it's even repetitive for them. And Jet Pilot and Shimmy were like, all right, if I have to pick two, it's going to be those. Any parallels? Any?
Yeah, no, I also cut Jet Pilot and Shimmy and Ardo. Ardo, R2, I'm not sure. That felt like a track that Maynard would want to throw on in the middle of a Tool record. Right?
Yeah.
Not the closer to this whirlwind of an album. A lot of what you said, I agree with. It doesn't make sense that this was huge, and it was huge.
Massive.
And it hit, it struck a chord with people. They had already kind of started to do that with their previous album. There was a couple of songs on their previous album that got kind of big. Sugar and Spiders, right? Those songs were pretty big.
Yep.
Among a few others. Sweet Pea, I think, was all right too. That record, but not to the level of this one. This one, absolutely massive. Like, everywhere and anywhere you could go, it was there. You would hear Chop Suey, you would hear Toxicity as singles. But yeah, this, we had a couple similar. Nate, what did you have what ones did you get rid of?
I got rid of Jet Pilot as well, X, yep. Arto, and Shimmy. Are those the same exact four as each one?
No, I didn't have X. I didn't have X.
Oh, okay.
You have another one too?
This is tough. I actually put Toxicity, but I think it's because I've heard it so much. So this is another one of those, like, I'm 36 now. Like, it's actually
you cut
really...
Toxicity? What the fuck are you on?
But that's a good angle, though, because, like, I, when listening through this today, I skipped the three singles, Ariel's, Toxicity, and Chop Suey.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you didn't have to listen to them, but I'm not cutting that one. No way. Sorry. That song is why they are where they one of the reasons they are where they are.
No, totally, totally. That's why this is such a hard exercise. You're, like, choosing your favorite child, you know?
Dig in, Nate. But, defend it. Come on. Defend it.
Let's argue. Let's go.
Well, like you said, Arto is an instrumental. Is actually similar to the Blink thing, just kind of like not random, but like, what is this? It's not taken away from the album, but it's definitely not necessary. Although I guess you could argue that maybe it's the vibe of who they are as a band, which is, you know, they're from Armenia, right? I think.
Yeah.
Jet Pilot and X immediately, like, I skipped those then and I somewhat skip them now. I play the album full through, but, you know, I always want, I'm always tempted to skip those two tracks. And then Toxicity, I don't skip. But like I was saying earlier, I've heard it so much that I'm like, you know, if I have to pick a song to cut, I chose that one. And it was tough, you know, because like you said, this album's fantastic. And to highlight what you said, Twan, it doesn't make sense that this album got huge. It's so out there and kind of reminds me of like a Frank Zappa, like just like super fucking random, out there, weird, experimental music that like maybe like it would resonate with like a certain crowd, but definitely not like major, you know, mainstream radio selling out arenas type music like at all. I think we liked it because we like all music. We did then, we do now. And that the crowd that, you know, became fans of this music were in that same vein. Like, yeah, I like Slayer and I like, you know, Linkin Park or whatever. Like I can kind of gravitate towards this music because it's just, like you said, it's all over the place. Maybe that's why, because it's all over the place that you can kind of gravitate towards it because it's not singular. But Serge, you know, he can sing, he can scream too. So there's always that dynamic of, you know, he's a true musician.
They all but, are. All four of them are.
They all are. Oh yeah, they're a tight, band for sure, especially live. But the deep cuts are so powerful. And I think I always like the political part of the band. You know, I think we always talk about Rage Against the Machine on here. So like the political aspect of System of a Down, band name aside, they're pretty deep. Like Prison Song right out of the gate is like you're getting educated. As a 16-year-old listening to this album, like, holy shit, this is what's really going on. And you start researching, like, oh, this is actually what's going on. Prisons are, you know, privatized. This is insanity. I didn't know that until I heard this song.
And I mean, it made mandatory minimum sentences a thing that we all like said in that weird Surge accent, right?
Yeah, I love it. That's the coolest part about this kind of music and free speech in general. It's like, oh, okay, so this is actually what's going on. And Needles and Deer Dance and, you know, all these songs are really deep lyrically. And so Toxicity is also a deep song lyrically. But when I had to like pick and choose, I cut that one to kind of make sure that I didn't have to cut a song like Prison Song or Deer Dance. So yeah.
I felt like there were a couple songs that you could have cut that were similar to other ones. Like I cut Needles, I cut Jet Pilot, I cut X, I cut Shimmy, and I cut R2. I almost kept, it was between X and Forest, and I was like, you know what? There's another, like, Deer Dance has its moments. Bounce has its moments as the similar to X type of vibe, so I left those, and I like those better. The reason I left Bounce is because I remember seeing them live for the first time in Portland at the Civic Center, and I think they either opened with it or it was the first song that, like, everybody went nuts, and I was like, this is cool. it was just one of those, like, okay, I saw it live, and I was in the middle of a pit just running for my life during that song. So I had positive connotations with that. But just listen to Dolmayan on the drums at the beginning of Toxicity, and I don't know how you could get rid of that song, man. It's just so damn
I know,
good.
Dude, it's tough.
I think it's through the lens of today. Back then,
yep.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it got played on the radio a ton, but you probably weren't sick of it back then.
No, and so I wrote down four. So there are four all-time songs on this record. Chop Suey, I think bar none, we can all agree with, is an amazing song.
Yeah.
Toxicity, similar. And then Aerials, which is a great song. But like we heard all of those three a ton on the radio. I'm kind of surprised that Toxicity was the one that you nixed. I think we heard Chop Suey even more. The other one that I put is all-time. Do you guys have a guess?
Deer Dance.
Nope. Also very
ETWA?
Good. Yep. That song is fucking awesome. Nice. I love that song.
Hell yeah.
It's so slow, then fast, then heavy, then not. And it's, man, that song, that's the perfect System of a Down song for me, is ATWA. I love that song.
100%. I agree wholeheartedly. And it's partly because I love bipolar music. So like one of my favorite Slipknot songs is The Nameless. You know what I mean? He sings, he screams. It's like all over the place. So yeah, ATWA fits that vein. Also, System of a Down is a song called Roulette off of Steelless album, which fits that vibe as well. And I relate it to Smashing Pumpkins. My favorite Smashing Pumpkins songs are the ones where Billy Corgan sings, even though it's full on rock band. So System of a Down, like these slower, I don't want to say ballad because they're definitely not like ballads, but slower tempo System of a Down songs are in my top like five, you know, throw it against like, you know, Prison Song or something like that, which is polar opposite. And like you said, Tuan, like this band is like all over the place. It's hard to stay focused. And I think that's why they resonate internationally. It's just like, it's not singular. And this album, as a sophomore album, their first album was kind of like Ozfest crowd. You know, if you knew them, you knew them. Like their first tour was like with Slayer and Clutch back in like 98. And they just gained popularity through their touring and so forth. So when this album dropped,
Slayer crowd did not like them.
Yeah, I read that too.
I listened to Serge was on with Rick Rubin on the Broken Record podcast last week, maybe, to talk about this, and because I think Rubin helped out with it, and Rubin called their music "Music for Crazy People," and yeah, the Slayer crowd was not into Soad, which was kind of surprised. I mean, a little surprising because there's some elements of that there, but it's also it's out there comparatively.
Yeah, it's really spastic. Nate, you kind of picked up where I was at one point. I wanted to make, which is, you're right. This was Ozfest crowd for self-titled, and then the crowd that came along with this album was more mainstream alt rock type audience. That's not what the music is, but that was where they ventured into, and I think it's the singles that opened that up, because someone who likes Aerials might not dig Psycho, which is interesting. I think they're back to back in the album, you know what I mean?
Yep.
Yeah.
And this is a play where had this album had different singles, like say they tried to go with Jet Pilot, like it wouldn't have hit. It did. But they, I mean,
yeah, that's a good call.
Do you guys know what ATWA stands for?
No, do you? Did you look it up?
I didn't until about 10 minutes ago. Air, trees, water, animals.
Huh.
Interesting.
So that fits right into their political, probably looking to do climate change-y type stuff back then.
Wouldn't surprise me.
The Rick Rubin thing, tone, I know this by memory, and I want to say it's 99% accurate that Rick Rubin saw System of a Down at the Roxy in Los Angeles randomly, like went to see them play live and started hysterically laughing. And then is like, literally like, I have to sign this band just because they're so hilarious.
You that piece I don't know is 100% sure, but yes, they talk, he and Serge talk about it in that podcast, talk about how they heard that Rick was going to be late backstage, and they're like, well, we need to wait till Rick gets here, because they were trying to get signed and,
oh, well,
you know, have him do, you know, work with him a little bit. So yeah. Yeah. Funny. That's a funny story.
Yeah. Because this album dropped, both albums, self-titled, and this one dropped on American Records, right? Which is Rick Rubin's imprint under some major label. I can't remember. I want to say
Columbia, I think. Yeah. It's Columbia.
Oh, Columbia. Yep. And I remember it had an upside down American flag and thinking like, oh, this is like this is in the vein of Rage Against the Machine. Right. Yeah. And the name just like spells it out.
It was it black and white too? The flag wasn't it black and white. The upside down flag. Yeah.
This definitely has occasional Rage vibes for sure. Prison Song obviously being the big one probably, but definitely has some Rage vibes.
I think you're right, Tone. And it's basically down to the deep lyrical content that's beyond, it was beyond us at the time, which is what we were talking about earlier, right? It's like textbook stuff, like, oh shit, this is exploiting what is actually going on, using free speech to the nth degree, like, you know, privatized systems and stuff that Zach De La Rocha would talk about, or like looking through like the booklet of like Evil Empire, and there's like a book list, right? Like the anarchist cookbook and stuff like that. You're like, holy shit, I'm like 15 years old. Like, what is this? Like, what's going on?
10 years old.
Yeah, 10.
Yeah.
The other thing that like adds to that list of the reasons why this shouldn't work is Serge, his vocals are almost like a fourth instrument or whatever. Yeah, fourth instrument, a third instrument, fourth instrument, where like if on a lot of these songs, he's, I don't even know if you call it singing. He just, he's vocalizing right in with the guitars. Like, da, 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 da. And that's like the exact, you know, staccato-ness or whatever of the guitars, where like, I don't know, some of it seems thrown together, but for them it's just, it's probably so calculated and it makes sense, and for the listener it's like it works. It just, it shouldn't work, but it does. I don't know,
calculated. Yeah. I think and just from what I've read and listened to, he wants to do that. I think he likes to make himself that fourth instrument and to like play off of the other three, and then at the same time play off Darren, right? Because Darren also is vocals too, and they sound so different.
Yes.
And you can hear it in numerous songs on this record and every other record they've done, but this one for sure, they play off each other really well in a couple of songs, namely Chop Suey, I would say, but it happens a lot. And Serge is obviously the main vocalist, but you get Darren and you get them kind of going back and forth. It's kind of wild the way they sound.
Yeah, that dichotomy you're talking about is showcased pretty heavily on Needles, right? Where it goes from Serge and then it goes to the breakdown with Darren singing, yep. I'm sitting in my room. It's like a creepy, Darren's got a weird, creepy-ish voice.
Yes,
it's kind of awesome.
I remember hearing that for the first time. It's awesome, but I remember the first time I heard it just being like creeped out, like this guy talking about a needle and a guy dying. Like, this is bizarre music. So like you said earlier, like this, it's weird that this album became, or this band became so massive. They should be like an underground band. You see it like a 800 cap club, like when they roll through, not arena. And, you know, I'm going to see them in LA in the fall. Like, they're playing the Bank of California stadium. Like, they're playing a stadium this fall, you know? So unbelievable. But I think it's that tribalism, those sounds you're talking about, the fourth instrument, like, I can see how that translates internationally, especially places like South America. But here in the States, like, I think people just like shit that's different. And System of a Down is one of a kind. They're in their own genre. There's nothing else like it.
To kind of bring it full circle to, like, you know, the purpose of this exercise, which was like, you know, reimagining the album and, you know, reduce the tracks. Even if you reduce the tracks, even if you took, you know, my five off or Tone's five, Nate's five off, this album still would have been as big, 100%.
Totally, yep.
It would have been, because, I mean, I think a lot of people did come for the singles.
Yeah.
This album still would have been big the way it was. It was big with the 15 songs. If you cut it to 10 and it was a little more succinct, yeah, this would have been massive. I just cut the couple that I thought that you already got it with one of the other ones and it didn't necessarily need to be both. What did you guys think would be a good opening song? Prison Song really is the best opening song for this, right?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Just listen to that, like, boom, and then quiet. Boom, boom, boom. It's fucking perfect. It feels perfect to me.
I actually have the track list pulled up, and I'm doing my best to think of the intros for each of these. And
same, yeah. And actually, the way you just described it, Tone, I think is the way to... Well, A, standard out, but B, I'm trying to think of the best way to open a show. So that's the best opening song for them to open a concert with, is Prison Song.
Yeah.
Right. So,
and Serge whispering, they're trying to build a prison. You're just like, whoa, yeah. What am I listening to?
Right. And it wouldn't work as a closer. It wouldn't work as, that's the best place for it. And that's the best song for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One thought, I actually just going through the track list is, so one thought about Chop Suey, when I went to see A Day to Remember a couple summers ago, the house music leading up to them coming on, which I think was their choice, one of the songs was Chop Suey, like right before they went on, house music, and the crowd sang it so loud, loudest I've ever heard anyone, I don't think I've heard anyone singing the house music. It was amazing, because like once... it became a thing, then it became an even bigger thing, and everyone was singing it. And it's like, damn, this song transcends. I mean, that's not even the same genre. Like, A Day to Remember, you know, mostly pop punk with breakdowns or whatever, heavy parts. But yeah, killer song that stood the test of time.
That just reminded me of the Frank Turner interview. People moshing and getting pumped during the house music.
There you go. Yeah, right? Exactly.
Yeah, that song, it does transcend. Like, it's probably the reason that I got into this record and got into, they're one of my gateways to heavier music too. Like, just listening to them and giving it the time of day, where a year or two younger me was like, no way, I'm out on that. And now I'm like, I love this. I need all of it. So they definitely opened a lot of people's our age's eyes at that time to a whole new world of heavy music.
How lucky were we to have that as a bridge into heavy music as a band like System of a Down, which is like way the fuck out there.
This is kind of pivoting into a deep dive here, but is there a better cover that they could have picked for the album? Like, it is perfect. Is there a better album name that they could have picked? I mean, both of those, they nailed it.
Yeah, no and no. You're right. They're perfect. They all lived in LA, grew up there. I think Shava was born out of the country, but he's only like three when he moved here. So they all grew up in LA, but they found each other even though they're all Armenian, which is kind of crazy. So to pull that off that way and use the like Hollywood sign with Toxicity is perfect.
Yeah, that's rad. I got another thing here, similar to the Blink thing. So the Blink songs they said that could replace the ones we cut are from I guess the secret songs on the different variants of Take Off Your Pants and Jacket. So check those out. But for System of a Down Toxicity, this album dropped in what, 2002, right?
2001.
20 years. Yeah. Right before 9/11. Okay, yep. Right before 9/11. Yep.
Oh, yeah. True, true. And then Steal This album dropped in 2002. And this is a B-sides album for the recording sessions for Toxicity. And I wrote down four songs that could replace the four that we dropped. So I don't know if you guys know much about this album, but Mr. Jack, I-E-A-I-A-I-O.
Yep.
Roulette and Streamline.
I don't know enough of those songs by titles.
Yeah, I'm not as familiar with those songs that way either. I would have to go back and check them. But you're thinking to like replace the ones that are on there, the 15 songs, and fit those in instead?
The 14 tracks, yeah, like those four tracks. Roulette is in vein of ATWA, kind of a slower, lower tempo song, but has the build up too.
Nice.
A-E-A-I-A-O or whatever is more like a, I don't know, could definitely fit next to Science or something like that. Mr. Nice. Jack is, I don't know, want to say like, I don't know, it could fit in the same kind of, you could tell it was in the same recording sessions. And then Streamline is literally like right in the mix too. So I remember getting that album being like, oh, there's some killer, and this like Steal This album's not a cohesive like front to back album, but there's some killer tracks on there, so you could kind of swap them out. And I actually think that's probably why they dropped it. They're like, oh, this is good material. It'd be a waste if we just like toss these. And I always thought that was cool for them to put out a full album of B-sides and say, hey, like we have these, we might as well press them. I feel like every band should do that. It's like, why the hell not? Like, people will appreciate it, and then you can play them live. It's like, it's more material for you guys to play live. Yeah. So,
and it makes sense, because was it Mesmerize came out in 2005. Steal This album was 2002. Yep. So it did bridge that gap, because 4 years goes by, some people move on.
When did Hypnotize come out? Because those came out kind of around each other.
Same year, I think.
Yeah, those were like double album, but not really at the same time.
Oh, Hypnotize
and Mesmerize.
Yeah, I think Hypnotize, Mesmerize was 05-06. And like you said, I think it was supposed to be a double album. They split it.
Yep.
I swear to God, I don't know this until we get someone from the band on, but I'm pretty sure it was supposed to be a double album. They split it from the record label pressure to just capitalize on two separate platinum records or something, you know?
Wow.
Yeah.
Wouldn't surprise me, just given the economics of it.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it's like if Chili Peppers had split Stadium Arcadium into two records. Yeah, instead of one. Yeah, you're right. This is turning into a deep dive.
Yeah.